GearNetwork.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
I believe it's a big challenge for our building to keep things in perspective and to if we're going to get addicted to anything, let's get addicted to the process.
And with that, we welcome you to Trust the Podcast, powered by Better Live Than Dead and the Gear Radio Network. This is episode number 87.
Episode 69. Plus 18.
That's the kind of information that we need on this podcast today, because it is not a fun one. The Buffalo Bills versus the Pittsburgh Steelers.
Yeah, I was kind of like, ooh, I remember a few seasons ago, this kind of being a regular thing.
Yeah.
But after, last year, I was not expecting to have a non-victory Tuesday episode so soon.
I agree with that. You can hear us on betterlivethandead.com, gearnetwork.com, and wherever you listen to podcasts. I am Ryan Wolfe at WolfBLTD, joined on the IndyCard Media Hotline by John Cimino at IMJCMoney. And John, I agree wholeheartedly with you. But then again, recently the Bills have not had real tough opponents, no offense to your New York Jets, on opening day. So the cupcake schedule goes away. The Buffalo Bills get a legitimate contender in Orchard Park in week one. And John, without any further ado, we'll just drop it on you here. The Buffalo Bills dropped their season opener to the Pittsburgh Steelers, 23-16. The Bills dropped to 0-1 on the season and currently sit third in the AFC East. There's some sort of breakdown as to how they're third, despite the fact that there are other 0-1 teams. I didn't really care that much to dig that deep into it. I'm just going to take NFL.com's word for it. But John, one thing I want to point out before we jump into our three big things, as usual, there was a full stadium at Highmark Stadium on Sunday in Orchard Park, which appeared to cause a struggle to control the COVID protocols. Now fans, John, they'll need to provide proof of vaccination, quote, for the games on September 26th and October 3rd. Fans will be permitted to enter with one dose of a COVID-19 vaccine. Beginning with the October 31st game, guests must be fully vaccinated for entry. Guests are considered fully vaccinated 2 weeks after their second dose in a two-dose series, such as the Pfizer or Moderna vaccines, or 2 weeks after a single dose, such as the Johnson & Johnson's vaccine. An Excelsior Pass or COVID-19 vaccination card are among the proper ID types. Reminder, a fake COVID-19 card is a Class D felony, you fucking morons. And I'm just going to say this really quick, John. Ha ha, ha ha, ha ha. All you stupid anti-vaxxers, this is what you get because, hey, look at, what's the saying, John? Give them rope and they'll hang themselves. Well, Erie County gave Bills fans rope, and my God, did they hang themselves? Because,
well, yes. I mean,
looking at photos of the concourse, John, I couldn't see one mask.
Oh, dude, I was watching the announcement on Channel 13's news at 5 o'clock while I was waiting for you, and they showed the concourse area of it being, you know, rather full without mask, people without masks in the whole nine. And I'm sitting there thinking of that, you know, just that like meme of what's his face behind the tree that kind of is like, he's got his hands together and he's looking like, but instead of his face, it's the COVID logo, like right over it. Like that's what I thought of when I saw that. And, you know, it serves everybody right. Because, you know, as a society, when you're a child, you know, you look to adults to kind of lead you in a good path, and you trust these adults to lead you in a direction that's going to set you up, not only you up for success, but the people around you for success and help you be a better person. But then when you get to being an adult, for some reason or another, everybody seems to just lose their sense of open-mindedness and willingness to learn and adapt, you know, to life. I don't know why that happens, but when you have a certain demographic of people that, you know, they're proud Americans and they love their football and, you know, they go through you hear dumb things of like the fake COVID-19 card, like you said, that costs money. You know what doesn't cost money? The vaccine.
Did you hear the story about the girl in Hawaii who spelled Moderna M-A-D-E-R-N-A and got busted and went to jail for it?
I would say that that's hilarious, but it's honestly par for the course.
It really is.
And one thing I did hear from the news that I don't see on the notes here that I think is worth pointing out is that Bills season ticket holders that do not want to get at least one dose of the vaccine or are non-vaccinated and refuse to come back, they will be eligible for a refund. Single season or single game ticket holders, on the other hand, will not be eligible for a refund. However, they can choose to sell them on the NFL ticket website thing where fans go and buy tickets or something like that. So that's something that I feel should be pointed out as well. If you're a season ticket holder, you know, you can go ahead and pout all you want and say you're not going to watch football and then watch football from home. At the very least, you'll get your money back.
Well, John, it's a violation of their amendment, of the First Amendment or whatever, you know.
Yeah,
that's all the dumb shit they say.
I would say this would, you know, this is going to greatly impact the Sabres as well, because the Sabres are following the same rule. Nobody goes to those games anyways, so it's not really going to be a big difference there. But honestly, selfishly for me, because the Pakulas also own the Amherst, is I'm hoping that this rule comes down to the Amherst, because then when those, you know, season ticket holders that don't want to be vaccinated say, I don't want my tickets, guess who's swinging through and picking up season tickets?
Can I make a full
Mafungo over here?
Yeah, can I make a full heel turn real quick? We've seen some of the Amherst season ticket holders. I got a feeling there's going to be a lot of tickets available.
Yeah. Yeah, you ain't kidding, man. You ain't kidding.
Well, that being said, my dog is mad because my wife is home. So let's roll over to the three big things real quick. We're getting hot and heavy here. Our three big things brought to you by PuckLuck.com, your one-stop resource for all your NHL sports betting action. PuckLuck provides win percentages and score projections, words are hard, for each and every NHL game to tilt the ice in your favor. Not sure what to bet or just in a rut? Or if you're mad like Drax, PuckLuck also provides expert picks to get the puck bouncing your way. Just a quick heads up, PuckLuck.com is in no way affiliated with the NHL, its teams, or the NHLPA. PuckLuck.com provides data related to gambling and cannot guarantee the success of any suggested or related wagers. Please gamble responsibly. With that being said,
yeah, what he said.
The first of our three big things, running down the offensive stats. This week, John, our first two of the three big things are kind of going to go together just because it will all make sense in the long run. And I didn't really want to have to repeat myself, but we'll just run down the three big offensive stats of the day. Quarterback Josh Allen, 30 of 51. That's right. You heard it correct. 51 passing attempts, 270 passing yards, and one touchdown with 9 rushes for 44 yards and 2 fumbles, 1 recovered and 1 was lost. Running back Devin Singletary, 11 rushes for 72 yards with 3 receptions for 8 yards. And wide receiver Isaiah McKenzie had ultimately the biggest offensive play of the game, which was the opening drive 75-yard kickoff return. Now, John, I'm not even going to spend time on that. I'm just going to say it is what it is. Those are what they are. And we're going to move on to what went wrong, the second of the three big things, because I think this is where we're going to spend a lot of our time this week.
Well, I can already tell you the first part of it, we've talked about ad nauseum. And as a matter of fact, as I recall last week, this was one of the very things that I had mentioned was problematic with this individual. But go ahead.
Absolutely. The offense struggled to find their mojo on Sunday, and a lot of it really seemed to have centered around quarterback Josh Allen, understandably so. Now, granted, it was pointed out that when Josh Allen played the Steelers last year and playing the Steelers this year, his stats are just about the same. They were able to beat the Steelers last year. This year, obviously, they did not. But Josh Allen said there is, quote, a lot to learn from with this tape, starting with me. Early on, just being too aggressive instead of finding some easier things, some easier throws. Now, John, this might sound absurd, but does Josh Allen get too amped up with full stadiums? And could this develop into a long-term problem if he can't get himself under control?
I don't necessarily know that it's completely a full stadium issue as much as it's a he gets too amped up issue. We've seen historically, going back to last year and the year before, and of course his first year, where if he's rattled, he's rattled, and he wears it on his face. And defenses really get after him, and he overcompensates, and that's when you start seeing him running a bit more, which, you know, yes, we know he's got the legs, but he's also susceptible to fumbles too. And particularly throwing long bombs that are, you know, 10 yards over his receiver, or 10 yards in front of his receiver, more often than not. Now, I preface this by saying I only caught highlights of the game. I didn't actually watch the full game, so I can't tell you how many times or if that happened or anything. But from what I was able to tell based on the Twitter and based on what I've seen from some highlights, Allen was rattled a little bit. And the Steelers are not the team to do that against. A Mike Tomlin-led team is always going to give you problems defensively, and that's what happened. They found I don't want to necessarily say a weakness, but they found something with Josh Allen that they worked with, and it worked to a T. You had some luck with the special teams there to kind of pad the points a bit, but it was pretty academic even before then that the Steelers ended up having control of this game long before that infamous play. And Josh Allen, yes, he does get very amped up. Is it with full stadiums? I can't tell. If full stadiums are the problem, that's something he needs to get over. But I don't think that it's that at all.
One of my friends said they need to get him a thunder blanket to get on the sideline like you get for your golden retriever to calm him down. He's too amped up. But really, John, the momentum shifted in this game after the half. Buffalo attempted 2 fourth down conversions, which I still am trying to figure out why. They failed on both. Pittsburgh turned both turnover on downs into 10 points. The second half opened up like this. Pittsburgh field goal, Buffalo turnover on downs, Pittsburgh field goal, Buffalo turnover on downs, Pittsburgh touchdown, and then the next drive, Pittsburgh scored a touchdown again on a blocked punt. This turned a 10-0 halftime lead into a 20-10 fourth quarter deficit. But John, it's not so much Pittsburgh's game plan as it was Buffalo's inability to execute. We talked about it last year, and it was pointed out by Touchdown Wire's Doug Ferrer, I believe is his name, in June 2021, quote, against 5 or more pass rushers in 2020, Josh Allen completed 150 of 226 passes for 1,791 yards, 884 air yards, 21 touchdowns, and just 2 interceptions. According to Pro Football Focus, in 2020, Josh Allen was blitzed on 56.5% of his dropbacks. Against the Steelers in week 1, he was only blitzed 12.5 times. So instead of feeding into what Josh Allen's strengths are, they held back. Yes, Pittsburgh did get a lot of pressure, which we're going to talk about in just a second here. But a lot of it was not on blitzing because they just said, look, we know that Allen is good against the blitz, so we're not going to do it. But the problem here, John, that really gets me is Buffalo's game plan just seemed to be off. They were without Zach Moss, who was a healthy scratch, who normally last year, not only was he a decent runner, but he's very good at pass blocking. So without Zach Moss, the Buffalo Bills decide they're going to go 5 wide empty sets, which essentially it's Buffalo's defense or Buffalo's offensive line versus Pittsburgh's defensive line. And Buffalo's offensive line did not fare well. They were called for 6 penalties, 3 of them being Deion Dawkins, who's still recovering from COVID. Whether or not you say that he's 100% or not, he did not look very good out there on the field. Those 3 offensive holding calls overshadow the only 2 calls he received all last season for offensive holding. So that's very bad. But furthermore, Pro Football Focus's Doug Kied. I listened to a video earlier with his name and I still screwed up. I'm so sorry. He reports.
I'm guessing it's Kied.
He reports Buffalo used play action on 17.7% of Allen's dropbacks in week 1, down from a 32.2% rate last season. Furthermore, when Allen has 29% or higher play action rate in a game, his PFF grade is 90.5. When he has a play action rate of under 29%, it's 54.4. So, John, what I'm gathering here is essentially Brian Daboll said, and the Bills whole as a whole said, our game plan is to take what we did last year and throw it in the trash because we're not going to do that. Well, they decided to spread five wide, which is not something Buffalo did very often. Mm-hmm. And when they did, they didn't have success. And then now they decide to not use play action to get Josh out of the pocket because the pocket was not very strong. And when it was, it just seemed like everybody was doing their own thing. Everybody was on a different page. Mm-hmm. And you can really tell just how ineffective the Bills offense was. Things were not clicking for them on Sunday.
It was not clicking for him, but you have to, I'm going to play a little bit of devil's advocate here. Cause I appreciate all the work you do in finding these stats and whatever. And I learn something new every podcast with you, Ryan, but I am coming from the place of a, you know, stereotypical stupid football fan here. When devil's advocate, biggest season ever, right?
Yep.
What has happened in this biggest season ever thus far besides week one happening just this past week? They cut down the preseason right to three games. Josh Allen didn't play much of the preseason. And, you know, when he did play in the preseason, it was sort of vanilla and he wasn't playing all the ones. And we all know that. That's what preseason is. But they cut down the preseason by one game and gave essentially a week and a half to almost 2 week break given, depending on when you played in that final preseason week. So you had a long stretch of time without NFL action of any kind whatsoever.
Absolutely.
And then you start week one a week later than you normally would have started had there been no alterations to the schedule to begin with. So part of me thinks it's still a little bit rusty. By all intents and purposes, should have been under normal circumstances, week three of the preseason, where they play into the third quarter, the starters play into the third quarter and get those reps and do all that and still kind of be in football shape without the preseason bye, so to speak. I think that's what a lot of it is, but if Brian Daboll's plan was to take what was there last year and throw it away, I would actually applaud him for that because that shows forward progressive thinking and always constantly changing things to make it difficult on other defenses. Now, sometimes you throw things to the wall and it sticks. Sometimes it doesn't. But you're in a division with the Miami Dolphins and Tua Tagovailoa, which, you know, give or take, it's either going to, you know, it's the Dolphins. You never know which Miami team you're going to get. They're very Jekyll and Hyde. The Patriots, who, you know, we don't know exactly who they are. And the New York Jets, the youngest team in the NFL that, you know, yes, they lost to the Carolina Panthers. They had a very abysmal first half of their game, but then they woke up and came back in the second half. And yes, they lost but they didn't look terrible in their loss. But the point is this Bills team is universally cohesive, has had the time with each other, and I think much is being made about this week one loss that really needs to be because of all of those little pieces. Yes, should they have executed better or could they have executed better? Absolutely. But in the same, if you had Aaron Rodgers on your fantasy team, he got you 0 points. So it's week one of the biggest season ever. I read Bills Twitter, and I say sadly because, you know, the Bills, the
it's a
that section, that section of the Bills Mafia, the one that I talked about at length last year, already back to normal. I guess maybe the fans were the problem and blah, blah, blah. And it's like, shut up, you know.
See, for me, that's a fun excuse to like make fun of Josh Allen and say he can't play in a full stadium.
Yes, but you're doing it for fun. They actually think that. And that's so silly to me after week one. Like, oh, great. Okay. We lost to the Steelers. It happens. It's week one and there's 16 more games to go. And your next contest is against the Dolphins in Miami.
Those people probably think that ivermectin is a very delicious snack.
Probably. Probably.
It's a shoot, baby. John, I agree with you. I'm just going to jump in and say I agree with you. I understand. Watching the game, very frustrating to watch the Buffalo Bills just continually spin their wheels. But you have to remember, whether or not we like Pittsburgh or not, and here on this podcast, the stance of Trust the Podcast is fuck the Steelers. And I'm sure Lewis would agree with that as well. If we
His wife wouldn't.
As well. Well, she's a nice lady, but we'll let that pass. We don't like the Steelers, but they're very good. We understand that. And it's kind of like a measuring stick because the Bills, I mean, the start of the Bills season, they could end up at their bye week at 500 because they play a lot of tough teams. But then again, they could come out and figure it out and crush, essentially crush ass. I mean, I'm just going to put it out there. A lot of the teams that we heard in the preseason that were tied with that Super Bowl contender moniker, I guess, got their asses handed to them this weekend. I mean, in some worse than others. We all can't beat the Green Bay Packers and get blown out by the New Orleans Saints and Jameis Winston, who is a national treasure at this point, despite the fact that off the field he's a terrible person or has done some terrible things.
He was young. He can grow out of it.
You know, it's really impressive when he gets on this train of thought and he goes, you know, it's like what my trainer said to me. What did he say? And then just forgets what he was saying.
That's a perfect, that is a perfect line. I'm totally stealing that.
That's a Jameis Winston. That's literally what he said in his post game.
Like, it's unbelievable. I'm totally stealing that. That is perfect.
This is the same man who ate the eight. Remember that he ate the W?
And his teammates
were like, bro, what is wrong with you? But well, anyway,
hey, he got that LASIK surgery and five touchdowns later. I mean,
that's got to be it. It's got to be what it is.
That was the problem.
So Green Bay loses. Tennessee gets beat up by Arizona. The Ravens lose to the Raiders. Mm-hmm. You've got the Bills losing to the Steelers. You've got the Browns losing to the Chiefs after having a double digit lead. So again, the teams that you considered to be quote unquote Super Bowl contenders, it's week one, as you say, John, of the biggest season ever. If the Bills come out and lay an egg against the Dolphins, then it's probably time to start panicking. But right now, they played a really good team. They played poorly against a really good team.
I mean, that if Bills fans are panicking right now, they're not. I would argue they're not really fans, and I would argue that they just became fans last year, because again, this is week one with a game with in a regular season that has one extra game.
It's week one of what though? I'm confused.
The biggest season ever.
Mm-hmm. Anyways, the budget's real low here for the podcast, so we got to make all the noises with our mouths on the podcast.
Yes, better making the noises with our mouths than out of our bums.
With that being said, John, going to take a quick break. We're going to come back for a third of the three big things. Here's not really much to talk about. It's just the bright side of the game that we have to mention, and then we're going to look ahead to week two and hopefully not despair. So with that being said,
I'm pretty sure we just heard the first fart joke in Trust the Podcast history.
I love it. I love it. We're making waves, fart waves. Anyways, we'll be back, John, right after this quick break with more Trust the Podcast.
I can't wait.
And we're back here on Trust the Podcast, as I promised.
Hey, John, really quickly though, I'm sorry to cut you off before you go to the third of the three big things. I want to make mention, because I know you mentioned earlier in the podcast where we can be heard specifically, but I would like to reach out to the listeners and let you know of additional ways that you can support this podcast without spending a dime. Way number one.
I thought you were going to say without listening to us.
No. Well, that actually could be way number two, but the first way to support this and any other podcast on the network is to literally just listen all the way through. That includes the commercials. Do not skip the commercials. Mute the commercials if you have to, but just let them play out. That helps us out a lot. And way number two that can help us out without costing you a dime or anything is wherever you listen to us, whether on betterlivethandead.com, gearnetwork.com, Odyssey, Pandora, wherever, Spotify, you name it, we are on there. Wherever you prefer to listen to your podcast, just do me a little favor and gently tap that subscribe button for the podcast, which is going, and that's going to ensure that you receive the latest podcast downloaded immediately upon release. You don't even have to wait for our social media plugs. You will get the downloaded podcast right to your device if you just click the subscribe button. Subscribe to this, subscribe to Better Live Than Dead, subscribe to the JC Money Show, listen in, all bets are off, all the Gear Network podcasts. Click that subscribe button, gently tap it, brush it with your hand, be very, very kind and caress it, but just hit that subscribe button and subscribe to the podcast. I promise you, it will cost you nothing, but it will help us tremendously. Back to you, Ryan.
Appreciate that. Well, that was really good because I don't have a whole lot to say in this segment, the third of the three big things. Defensively impressive. Not all was lost on Sunday, John. The Bills' defense appeared to pick up right where they left off in 2020. Jordan Poyer and Mario Addison both recorded a sack. Hip, hip, hooray.
Hip, hip, hooray.
The Bills' defense held Ben Roethlisberger to 188 passing yards and one touchdown, and Pittsburgh amassed only 75 total rushing yards on 21 carries. So, end of the day, not a bad day defensively.
I honestly feel like the difference between this game, based on, you know, everything I'm reading and the highlights I'm seeing, the difference really was that special teams play and a couple of times that the Bills got cute with those going for it on fourth down.
The Bills offense shitted down its leg.
Mm-hmm. It farted and shitted.
It thought it could trust it. It could not trust it. Mm-mm. Our look ahead, John. Week two, the Buffalo Bills at the Miami Dolphins. Miami is 1-0 first in the AFC East. They defeated what's the quarterback? Matt Jones' real name?
And those clowns are already talking about how great this freaking thing. I swear to God, the Dolphins are seriously the Cowboys of the AFC. It's so freaking terrible.
What's Mac Jones' real name? I forget.
Mac Jones' real name. Oh, damn it.
It's like McElroy or something.
McElmore or something like that. Hang on.
McElmore. Yeah, that's what I'm going with. The Dolphins.
Michael McCorkle Jones.
McCorkle. That's what it is.
Michael McCorkle Jones.
We probably should have just stayed with McElmore because that was actually better. But McElmore McCorkle. Jones and the
McCorkle Jones. No, I like McCorkle Jones.
McElmore Jones and the Patriots lose. Dolphins are 1-0, 17-16 in week one. This kind of honestly
McCorkle sounds like a name that rich people would like call their penis or something.
I would buy it. Yeah, absolutely. Oh,
better watch out. Make sure you clean your McCorkle when you take a shower there, Ryan.
Yeah. You know, yeah, I got you. This is going off the rails and I love it. So the Dolphins.
This is what happens when the Bills lose, damn it.
Exactly. The Dolphins and the Patriots game, it was kind of like a mirror image of the Bills and Patriots because the Bills offense got all the stats but lost the game, whereas the Patriots offense got all the stats but lost the game. Miami quarterback Tua Tagovailoa, 16 of 27, 202 passing yards, one touchdown, one interception with four rushes for 1 yard and a touchdown in week one. Miami only amassed 74 rushing yards on 23 attempts, and their defense allowed 281 passing yards and 125 rushing yards in week one. So not a whole lot to write home about. I'm thinking I'm just going to put it out there. The Buffalo Bills are going to come out, take care of business, maybe a 24-13 or 24-10 victory. Maybe they decide to lay it on and go a little crazier, but 24-10 Bills. I'm hoping they defeat the Miami Dolphins. And real quick, I saw this on Twitter. I know we all say squish the fish because like it's cute and funny, but it literally doesn't make sense because dolphins are mammals. And have you tried to squash a mammal before? Like,
so
it doesn't make sense.
So I'm going to bring it back to a time period that I remember very well when that tagline was created. It was created by the very, and Ryan, you were a baby, you were a kid back then. Okay. So I will explain to you and hopefully this will make sense. Okay. When that line was created, it was created by a group of people that very likely will be receiving refunds on their tickets, their season tickets this year.
I love how you bring it back. With that being
said, 31-17 Buffalo.
Let's lay it on like the ivermectin paste.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I was, you know what? You reacted the way that I wanted you to. That's why I built it up the way I did.
Does it not make sense though? It is the truth. Yeah.
All right.
Oh, my dog just stepped on my testicle. Oh my Lord.
All right. Very good. So we've had fart jokes. We've made fun of people that don't understand the difference between mammals and fish. And your dog, who's now a regular on this podcast, went ahead and stepped on your left McCorkle there.
My left McCorkle. That's correct. Well, I guess there's no time like the present to wrap this train wreck up.
Breathe, Ryan. Breathe. I'll close this one out here.
I'm good to go. I was going to say, sure? I'm good to go. It just might take me a second.
Okay, yeah. Remember, ladies and gentlemen, click that subscribe button, please, wherever you listen. Please, that will help us out. And again, it doesn't cost you a dime, just cost you 20 seconds of your time.
John is at I am JC Money. I am at Wolf BLTD, as always.
At Crush Nuts, NUTZ.
At Crush McCorkle.
There we go.
69420.
All right.
We are Trust the Podcast.
You're not.
If you're still listening, we appreciate you so much. Make sure to tune in to next week's debacle. Hopefully, it will be much more better and more exciting than this one. Although I have to argue, John, this may be a very good podcast, and we're just not giving it enough credit.
Oh, I think this is a great podcast. I'm very happy with how it sounds, and I look forward to the playback.
Honestly. I'm looking forward to it as well.
And thanks, I'm looking again, everybody. Forward to all of you subscribing. Please remember to do that. Thank you.
Hell yeah. Appreciate everybody tuning in. As always, we'll catch you sometime next week. And as always, go Bills.
McCorkle.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.